What if 80% of the unit tests you ever made only micromanage your implementations without adding safety from bugs? What if that focus on unimportant aspects left the back door open for a genuine bug you never thought of? I will make both of these deadly sins so you can see how that happens. I will then correct myself and show you a much easier and more effective way of writing unit tests. This unit test is just a placeholder. It instantiates a domain model from a much larger project I have here. That project is a bookstore web application that mainly deals with books and their authors. I might want to test this static factory method. Did it return the book I expected? I will focus on authors only in this example. Given some authors, when I pass them to create new, then they must appear in the same order. I have applied that given when then naming convention for tests. You may choose a different convention, but the issue is with what I am testing, not the test's name. I am asking too many questions here for no apparent reason. I am micromanaging the method under test. It's time to uncover that greatest secret of unit testing that nobody ever told you. The class you are testing is not your enemy, and the programmer whose task is to implement it is not an undercover agent sent to secretly plant bugs in your project. Let me show you the fallacy of this test method. I will give you a riddle that will bend your mind by only asserting the count of authors that the book contains when Create New constructs it. Both tests will pass, and I will argue that they are ensuring the same level of safety from bugs regarding populating the book model with author models. I challenge you to tell me why you think the first test is testing more than the second one. What bug can I make that the first test will catch and the second test will not? That will bring you to the revelation. I am about to implement this method, but I am not your mortal enemy. I will not invest effort in writing incorrect code that satisfies your tests. How can I make the first test fail but the second one pass? Let me try it out by reversing the order of authors from the input. Sure, that failed. You got me red-handed. I could try other mischiefs here too, like taking only two items from the sequence. Sort the authors by the last name also comes to mind. But now, if you still don't see the hidden message I'm trying to convey, read the test results. The first test seems to be the strong guy here. It knows everything and nothing escapes its eye. Still, it didn't catch the bug. By pure luck, the test data have already been sorted in this order. There are two lessons you should learn from this simple example. One is that you cannot go against me if I'm implementing the class. The other is that if you invest in going against me, in which you will never succeed, you will miss more important things. That makes it a double fault on the side of unit tests. So here is the revelation. Rule number one of software development is that programmers are as lazy as a lazy bag. If there is the line of code that does the job and the line of code that is the same as the first one, but adds a bunch of other stuff at its end, a healthy programmer will always choose the former. If your colleagues append needless garbage to an already complete implementation, you should talk to them rather than add irrational unit tests to counter their lunacy. The rule you should nourish in your team is this: always write the most straightforward code that works. Then check the unit tests. This is simpler, but it doesn't work. The method's return type is non-nullable. This may look like less thinking, but it doesn't work either. The input argument is grayed out. That alarms me immediately. The correct implementation is the simplest one that looks sane. So it seems to me. Build this mindset into your team and you will have fewer things to worry about. That brings us to the second deadly sin I committed to writing the first test. Focusing on unimportant details so much that I forgot what was important. Look, I will remember the original authors in an array before creating the book. And then I will alter one of the objects. I will assert that this action, which happens entirely outside the book, did not affect the book. I am running the tests and the new test is failing. My prior dispute with myself about whether I should test the content or just the count has deflected my attention from the substantial question. Did the domain model isolate itself from an external collection? It didn't. Now that there is one additional unit test, this one's simplest solution is simpler than possible. It requires an addition, this time requiring it genuinely. The simplest of all additions that come to mind is to capture the input sequence into a private list. Now the tests will pass, I'm sure of that. At a philosophical level, why do I think it is sufficient only to count the elements? It is because the underlying implementation cannot fake that number. It must create a collection with that many elements. And then what elements will it put there? What options does it have? All it can ever do is take the authors from the method's argument. I told you already. The guy who implements this method is neither your enemy nor a secret agent sent to put doom upon your project. Don't write endless tests, constantly feeling one more is missing to plug one more loophole. That is the road to madness. Worse yet, while wasting willpower writing those ridiculously detailed tests, you will forget a substantial one and then a real bug will pass under your radar. I was cheating. This model will never work with Entity Framework Core. The database has a many-to-many relationship between books and authors modeled with a helper model book author. The author's property is in fact a calculated sequence. There is nothing to set here in the construction process. The process requires a call to a helper factory method. The application will now work fine, but why have I shown you this? Watch. After substantially changing the model under test, the unit tests are still passing. That is because I was not testing implementation, only the publicly visible attributes I considered critical for an application. The implementation, however complicated, is still the simplest possible one. Let that be your most valued rule. Strive for the most straightforward implementations that satisfy unit tests. Don't add anything more than that, and there will be nothing more to cover with tests.